Computers are becoming increasingly capable of tasks that we often think of as requiring intelligence. Answering questions, producing art, driving cars, diagnosing disease, and more. But how did our artificial intelligence systems learn to perform these tasks so well? Many of these systems are based on machine learning and neural networks. But where did these ideas come from, and how do they work? That's the story we're going to be exploring together, the story of how we taught computers to learn. It's a big story, and we won't touch on every topic, but the goal is to appreciate some of the history, some of the mathematical principles, and some of the key algorithmic ideas that have given rise to the techniques that power artificial intelligence today. We start our story with one of the pioneers of computer science, Claude Shannon. In 1950, Shannon engineered a robotic mouse that could navigate its way through a maze. The maze was a 5x5 grid with barriers that could be moved around. The robotic mouse, called Theseus, as Shannon pronounced it, would start by exploring the maze. It couldn't see, but when it hit one of the barriers, it would rotate counterclockwise and try a different direction. Once the mouse had navigated its way to its goal, Shannon could put the mouse back in the maze in a different position, and the circuitry controlling the mouse from beneath the maze would remember the path to the goal and could guide the mouse there. How did it work? For each square of the maze, two telephone relay switches would remember which direction the mouse last exited that square. Depending on whether those switches were off or on, that would represent north, east, south, or west. So once Theseus had been through the maze once, each square the mouse visited would remember which direction to go if the mouse were to ever revisit that square again. The logic was quite simple, as Shannon himself acknowledged, but it was one of the first examples of a machine learning. Theseus would navigate the maze and learn from its experience for the next time. Shannon wasn't the only one thinking about intelligent machines in 1950. In that same year, another pioneer of computer science, Alan Turing, published the now famous paper Computing Machinery and Intelligence. The first computers were only a few years old at the time, but Turing was already considering the question of whether a computer could think. To make the question more precise, Turing proposed a test. Put a human interrogator in one room, and a human and a computer together in another room. The interrogator types out a question, any question they'd like in plain natural language, and they can ask the question to player X or player Y or both. The players reply to the interrogator's question, and the interrogator sees whether the reply came from X or Y, but they aren't told which player is the computer. The interrogator can keep asking any questions they like, but after some number of minutes, they need to decide. Is player X the human, or is player X the computer? The question, then, is not whether computers can think, but whether computers can behave so intelligently that we can't distinguish it from human thought. Turing didn't know how to build a machine to achieve this, but he did have some ideas. At the end of his paper, he speculated that while it might be difficult to encode the mind of an adult human into a computer program, it might be easier to program a computer to behave like a child's brain. And if we could do that, then we could teach it, through experiences and rewards and punishments, to eventually end up with a computer as intelligent as an adult. Claude Shannon, too, was thinking beyond his maze-solving mouse to what it would take to build more intelligent machines. Earlier that year, in March of 1950, he published a paper describing a machine that was able to compete against humans in a game of chess. Shannon was a chess player himself, and had given a lot of thought to how to program a computer to play chess. He recognized that the optimal algorithm would be to calculate all the possibilities by brute force and pick the best move, but he knew that this would be impractical. But he tried to use his own knowledge of the game. That some pieces are worth more than others, that some piece configurations are stronger or weaker, that pieces with more mobility have more good options, to devise heuristics that would let a machine play a good game of chess without needing to explore every possible position. The machine could explore a fixed number of moves, and then call a function that used these heuristics to evaluate the strength of the board position. Even still, though, Shannon acknowledged the limitations of the machine he was describing. Its weakness, he said, is that it could never learn. Humans can get better at chess the more they play, but this machine wouldn't be able to do that. He gave some thought as to how to get the computer to learn from experience, but found the ideas impractical. But he suspected that maybe some algorithm could learn from the results of games and update his function for evaluating game positions to make the evaluation process more accurate in the future. Both Turing and Shannon in 1950 recognized that an algorithm that could learn would be a powerful tool for building intelligent machines, but neither of them knew exactly how to do that. Part of the answer, it would turn out, would be born from work already done just 7 years earlier, when a neuroscientist named Warren McCulloch, along with logician Walter Pitts, were working together on an entirely different problem. McCulloch and Pitts were trying to model the behavior of neurons in the human brain. Neurons in the brain can fire or not fire, and whether they fire depends on the activity of other neurons that are connected via synapses. McCulloch and Pitts observed that this could be modeled with logic, namely propositional logic, where propositions are either true or false, one or zero. So they developed a mathematical model for neural activity. In their model, each neuron's activity was all or none. It was either a one or a zero. Neurons were connected to each other, and each neuron could have a threshold for how many of its inputs needed to fire in order to excite the neuron itself and cause it to fire. So, for example, if there were three input neurons and the threshold was two, then if one of the inputs fired, then the output neuron wouldn't have reached its threshold and it wouldn't fire. But if at least two of the inputs fired, the output neuron would add up the number of firing inputs, see that it reached its threshold, and it would fire too. That could then excite other neurons further ahead in the network. Their model also allowed neurons to have an inhibitory input, which completely prevented the neuron from firing, no matter what happened in any of the other neurons. So even if the neuron would have otherwise reached its threshold, if an inhibitory input fires, the output neuron won't fire. This model allows networks of neurons to represent logical functions. The logical AND function, which takes two inputs and outputs true when both of its inputs are true, could be represented by two neurons connected to a neuron whose threshold is 2. When both inputs fire, the output fires 2. Changing the threshold from a 2 to a 1 results in the network computing the OR function instead of the AND function. Either one of the inputs firing is enough to get the output to fire. And using an inhibitory input with a threshold of 0 simulates a NOT function that inverts its input. When the input doesn't fire, the threshold 0 is met and the output fires. When the input does fire, that inhibits the output neuron from firing, so it doesn't fire. The neural networks designed by McCulloch and Pitts could compute more complex logical functions too, by chaining together more layers of neurons. But these neurons never learned anything. They just calculated mathematical functions. McCulloch and Pitts weren't focused on learning. They were just trying to find a mathematical way to describe neural activity. But in their not-too-distant future, computer scientists would be looking to their work as a foundation on which to build machines with the ability to learn. That's what the rest of this series will explore. We'll look back at the early mathematical ideas that laid the groundwork for machine learning centuries before Alan Turing speculated about intelligent machines, and we'll look at the approaches that built on the work of people like Shannon and McCulloch and Pitts, the problems that arose and the solutions that were invented, all in an effort to teach computers to learn.